Hello everyone, welcome to the case review session of cold tumor. Let's review this case. This is a case of a 20-year-old male who presented with a painless hard mass in the popliteal fossa. He stated that the mass had been present for several years and did not change in size. This is the lateral radiograph of the knee of the patient, and we will evaluate this lesion on the following subheadings. First is age of the patient. So as we know, age of the patient is 20 years, so he is a young male. Second, whether the lesion is single or multiple. So as we can see, the lesion is single. Skeletal location. So as we can see, the lesion is involving appendicular skeleton and it is involving long bone, that is distal femur. What is the site of long bone involvement? As we can see, the lesion is involving metaphysis of distal femur and the lesion is pointing away from the joint. Pattern of growth and bone destruction. So the lesion is basically a bony outgrowth with no obvious destruction. There is no obvious periosteal reaction and matrix mineralization, and the lesion can impinge on the adjacent soft tissue. So this is a case of a sessile bony outgrowth at the distal femur metaphysis. The femoral cortex and medulla are continuous with those of the lesion. So this is a case of sessile osteochondroma or exostosis. Osteochondroma is a benign cartilaginous tumor, but there are certain features which suggest malignant transformation into chondrosarcoma, and this malignant transformation is seen in less than 1% cases of solid tumor osteochondroma and 20% cases in diaphyseal ecclesia. So the rate of malignant transformation is higher in diaphyseal ecclesia. So there are certain clinical and radiographic features which suggest malignant transformation. The clinical features are advanced age, lesions in the pelvis and shoulder, and increasing pain and mass at the site of known osteochondroma. Whereas the radiographic features are thick and irregular calcified cap, bone destruction, soft tissue mass, and altered appearance on sequential studies. This is the radiograph showing multiple sessile and pedunculated osteochondromas involving bone surrounding bilateral knee joint. So this is a case of diaphyseal ecclesia, and rate of malignant transformation in diaphyseal ecclesia is around 20%. This is a case of solitary pedunculated osteochondroma, and the direction of osteochondroma is away from the joint. This is a case of osteochondroma involving neural arch of the cervical spine, and this is a CT of the same patient. This is the case of a 1-year-old female who presented with tender swelling all over the body with rashes and enlarged lymph nodes. These are multiple radiographs of the patient covering skull and long bones of upper and lower limb. So again, we are going to evaluate this lesion on the basis of multiple criteria, which include first the age of the patient. So this is a case of 1-year-old female, so this is a very young child. Second, the lesions are single or multiple. So as you can see, there are multiple lesions. Skeletal location. So as you can see, the lesions are involving axial as well as appendicular skeleton. Sites of long bone involvement. As you can see, the lesions are involving diaphysis and metaphysis of long bones. Pattern of growth and bone destruction. So these lesions are having geographic and moth-eaten pattern of bone destruction. There is no obvious periosteal reaction, and there is no obvious matrix mineralization. And these lesions are having adjacent soft tissue involvement near the osteolytic lesions. So this is a case of a 1-year-old child with systemic symptoms and multiple well-defined punched out lytic lesions in skull and long bones. So this is a case of Langerhans-Cell histiocytosis. So Langerhans-Cell histiocytosis can be divided into three categories. First is the unifocal or localized form. Second is multifocal unisystem chronic recurring form. And third is the multifocal, multisystem, fulminant form. The first category is unifocal or localized form, which actually composes of 70% of LCH cases, and it is limited to single bone or few bones, and it may involve the lung. It affects 5 to 15 years of age. Second is the multifocal unit system form, which comprises 20% of cases. It affects multiple bones as well as reticuloendothelial system like liver, spleen, lymph nodes and skin. It is often accompanied by diabetes insipidus because of involvement of the pituitary gland, and the age group involved is 1 to 5 years of age. The third and the most severe or pulminant form is multifocal multisystem form, which comprises 10% of LCH cases and it is often fatal. It is typically diagnosed in the first 2 years of life and it is characterized by disseminated involvement of the reticuloendothelial system, leading to anemia and thrombocytopenia. So LCH has a predilection for the flat bones. Skull is the most common flat bone involved, followed by mandible, ribs, pelvis and spine. And skull lesions have characteristic beveled edge because of unequal involvement of the outer and inner table, and it gives an appearance of geographic skull. So this is the radiograph showing a lesion in the skull having beveled edge and geographic skull appearance. Symmetric uniform collapse of the vertebral body is a frequent finding and it is known as vertebra plana. The femur, humerus and tibia are the most commonly involved long bones. Destruction of the mandible isolates and displaces the tooth, which gives rise to floating teeth sign. This is the radiograph of the mandible showing floating teeth sign. So this was all about Langerhans and histiocytosis, which predominantly affects pediatric age group. This is the case of a 7-year-old male who presented with swelling in the right proximal arm for 5 months. This is the frontal radiograph of the right shoulder of the patient. And again, we are going to evaluate this lesion on the basis of following criteria. First is age of the patient. So age of the patient is 7 years. He is a skeletally immature patient. The lesion is single. Skeletal location is appendicular skeleton involving long bone. Site of long bone involvement is metadiaphyseal and it is central with mild expansion. Pattern of growth and bone destruction. So the lesion is having geographic pattern of bone destruction with narrow zone of transition. There is no obvious periosteal reaction and there is no obvious matrix mineralization and there is no obvious soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of a well-defined, mildly expansile central lytic lesion located in the proximal humerus, metadiaphyseal in location. So this is a case of simple bone cyst, also known as unicameral bone cyst. Simple bone cyst is not a true neoplasm. The most common sites of involvement include proximal humerus, proximal femur and calcaneus. It is predominantly metaphyseal and diaphyseal in location. The lesions have geographic pattern of bone destruction. These are central elongated lesion with mild expansion, endosteal scalloping and with no obvious periosteal reaction. Pathological fracture can be seen and it can be the first clinical sign. Fallen fragment sign is seen in 10% of cases. This is the radiograph of left hip joint showing simple bone cyst with complicated pathological fracture. This is another radiograph of the proximal humerus showing simple bone cyst with fallen fragment sign. This is another case of simple bone cyst involving proximal humerus with pathological fracture in a skeletally immature patient. Differential diagnosis will also include fibrous dysplasia. So this was all about simple bone cyst or unicameral bone cyst. This is the case of a 28-year-old male who presented with bilateral hip pain. And this is the AP radiograph of the pelvis, bilateral hip joint and also including bilateral femur. So again, we are going to evaluate these lesions on the basis of following criteria. First is age of the patient. So as we can see, the age of the patient is 28 years. The lesions are multiple. Skeletal location is appendicular skeleton and it's involving long bone. The site of long bone involvement is predominantly diaphyseal, but it is also involving metaphysis. Pattern of growth and bone destruction, so that these lesions are causing bone expansion with endosteal scalloping and cortical thinning. There is no obvious periosteal reaction, and if at all it is present, it is of non-aggressive type. There is no obvious matrix mineralization and soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of expansion of bilateral femur with endosteal scalloping, cortical thinning, ground dressing and bowing. So this is a case of polyostotic fibrous dysplasia. Fibrous dysplasia are benign lesions. These lesions are basically asymptomatic, and bone deformities and pathological fracture are the most common causes of symptoms. Bone deformities are called as Shepherd group deformity. Capillary spots are seen in 30% of patients with polyostotic fibrous dysplasia. McCune-Albright syndrome represents polyostotic fibrous dysplasia with skin pigmentation and precocious puberty. This is the case of a 12-year-old male who presented with swelling in bilateral hands. This is the PA radiograph of bilateral hands of the patient. So we are going to evaluate these lesions on the basis of following criteria. First is age of the patient. So age is 12 years and he is a skeletally immature patient. The lesions are multiple. Skeletal location is appendicular skeleton involving small bones of hands. The site of long bone involvement is metadiaphyseal. The pattern of growth and bone destruction. So the lesions are causing expansive-like lesions with geographic pattern of bone destruction and endosteal scalloping. Type of periosteal reaction is non-aggressive type. Pattern of matrix mineralization with cartilaginous matrix with ring and arc pattern of calcification. And there is no obvious soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of expansile lytic lesions with geographic pattern of bone destruction and endosteal scalloping involving multiple small bones of both hands. So this is a case of Ollier disease or onychomatosis. So Ollier disease is a non-hereditary sporadic skeletal disorder characterized by presence of multiple onychomas. And there is an increased risk of chondrosarcoma, which can occur in later stages of life. Ollier disease is associated with presence of soft tissue hemangioma, characterized by presence of flagellate on the radiograph. This situation is known as Maffucci syndrome. So this was all about Ollier disease or onychomatosis. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you.